I call upon the Joint Director of Directorate of Public Libraries and the Chief Librarian and Information Officer of Anna Centenary Library to felicitate our chief guest with a memento. Thank you. Now, I call upon Ms. Shanti, Librarian of Anna Centenary Library, to give a glimpse of the profile of our chief guest.
Thank you, Reena. Dr. Satish Kumar Saravanan, the theoretical physicist researching on binary black holes and gravitational waves, was born in Salem in 1987. Dr. Satish Kumar Saravanan, a physics graduate from St. Joseph College, Tiruchi, completed his post-graduation from University of Delhi. He was an Erasmus Mundus Scholar at Free Universität Berlin, Germany, and a Salahuddin Postgraduate Fellow at the National Institute for Subatomic Physics. He completed his PhD from Lawrence Institute for Theoretical Physics, Leiden University, Netherlands, with a doctoral thesis on spin dynamics in general relativity under the guidance of Professor J.W. Van Hoyltonk. The area of his research interests are gravitational physics, general relativity, relativistic geophysics of black holes and neutron stars, relativistic hydrodynamics, equations of motion, and world line perturbation theory. Currently, he is a Riemann Fellow at Riemann Center for Geometry and Physics, Leibniz University, Hanover, Germany. We once again welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Shanti. Now, I request our chief guest to speak to the audience.
Good evening to all. So, as it was introduced, I would like to talk about black holes, neutron stars, and gravitational waves today under the title Once Upon a Space Time. Is it okay for you people if I mix both English and Tamil to explain? Shown here, one is strong nuclear force and weak nuclear force, electromagnetic force, and gravitational force. So the strong nuclear force, which is responsible for combining or binding the nucleons like protons and neutrons, and the weak nuclear force, which is responsible for the radioactive decay, like emitting the subatomic particles. And the electromagnetic force is the responsible for binding electrons with the protons or binding the atoms together. And the fourth one, which is gravitational force, which is responsible for everything in the universe on the larger scale, like binding the galaxies, planets, stars, planets, and so on. So in today's talk, I'll be covering completely on the gravitational force. So when you say gravity, we are all familiar with the Newton's apple, right? Yeah, I would be happy if students or anybody, if you want to enter in the middle and if you want to ask questions, okay? I'd be very happy to stop in the middle. So please feel free to stop. Just raise your hand, I will stop it and ask you, okay? Okay, so when you say gravity, we're all familiar with the Newton's apple story, that Isaac Newton, when he was sitting under an apple tree, he observed that an apple was falling from the tree under the ground, and he realized that the reason was, he caught it as gravity, okay? And he also realized that the moon, which is orbiting around our Earth, is also governed by the same force, gravity. Not only the moon, the planets which are orbiting around the sun because of the same force, which he called it as gravity, okay? From his observations, he framed a law, which is law of gravitation. The students, the plus one, plus two students must be knowing this, right? It states that when two bodies, either they are in earth or in heaven, either it is in the state of motion or in rest, always they mutually attract with each other with a force proportional to the product of their masses, and inversely proportional to square of the distance between them. So I would like to say that don't think that I'm going to show too many formulas. I'm going to show only a couple of formulas today. So the rest are conceptual. So from this, you could see that the force is proportional to the product of the masses, and it's inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. And this formula works very well in explaining the moon orbiting around the Earth, or planets orbiting around the sun, or in brief, it works excellent within the solar system. Okay, but the universe is not just the solar system. Universe is far big than the solar system, right? So the question is whether this law is universal. The answer is no, because suppose if I'm moving this mass, let's say I'm moving this or any one of these mass closer to this another mass, and since R is a mutual distance between them and it is inversely proportional to their force, when you move this mass, the force changes instantly, which means without any time delay. This implies that something is traveling with an ultimate speed, which is actually nonsense, so to speak, because nothing can travel faster than the speed of light, right? So at that time, nobody knows what is the ultimate speed of light. But since this formula was working well enough inside the solar system, this was the law of gravitation during Newton's time. And in fact, for around 200 years, nobody knows the answer if there is a better law than this. Only in 1987, okay, there is one more thing which is missing in this formula. Suppose if the mutual distance between them goes to zero, let's say R is zero, then the force becomes infinity, which is, again, it's a nonsense, right? So there is something missing and there is something wrong in this formula, though it works very well in the solar system. So it was eventually Albert Einstein, after 200 or 250 years, realized what is missing. Before Einstein, Michelson Morley, with their interferometric experiments, in 1887, they proved that the ultimate speed in the universe is the speed of light. Okay. So by taking this proven fact, this experimentally proven fact, Einstein had a thought experiment. Suppose he imagined, you know, suppose a man is standing in a platform and a train is passing through the platform in a very extremely high speed. Okay. And during that time, suppose two lightning bolts hits the train, one at the front end and one at the back end. And this man who is standing in the platform is observing this lightning bolt. obviously he will observe both the lightning bolts at the same time, right? So this is fact one. Now imagine the same another guy who is sitting exactly in the middle of this train, and this train is pausing, and that the guy inside the train, if he looks at these two lightning bolts, he will observe the lightning bolt which is hitting in the front side first. Later, after a certain time delay, he will look at the second one. Actually, the event is the same event, but for different observers, it looks different, right? Which says something to us, which means even though the event is same, the time can dilate, or the time can be different for both the observers. So this is one of the beautiful thought of Albert Einstein during his lifetime. From this, he framed the special theory of relativity. Okay. Then he said that space and time cannot be separately treated. It was until 1905, based on Newtonian mechanics, everybody thought that space and time are two different entities. Space is something where events take place, and time is just a measure of change of it. But it was only in 1905 Einstein revolutionized that idea, saying that both time and space are intimately connected. Which means, if you want to represent any activity in the universe or any event in the universe, you always need to consider the time as a fourth dimension. From then, the space and time are not called as space and time, rather it is space-time. So this is a story in 1905, right? It's a special theory of relativity. And after that, Einstein worked for 10 years alone. Then he came out with another beautiful theory, which is a more generalized version of special relativity, which is general theory of relativity. Okay? The core essence of general theory of relativity is wherever there is a mass, there is a curvature around it. For example, if you look at this figure, suppose there is a bigger ball here. There is the space-time the space-time should get curved around that. The bigger the mass, the bigger the curvature. The lower the mass, lower the curvature. And this curvature will vanish when you go away from the mass. Okay, this is the central essence of general theory of relativity, which he described with his famous field equations. From this, I would like to say that, you know, the left-hand side is describing the curvature part, where this R is called the Riemann curvature. But this R describes the curvature part, and this T denotes mass or energy. Okay? So this says that wherever there is mass or energy, there is a curvature, or other way around, wherever there is a curvature, there should be mass or energy. So this is the general theory of relativity. So, also, this formula also indicates that mass produces space-time curvature, and the space-time curvature determines the mass of the motion. Which means, you know, from the Newtonian mechanics, everybody thought that, or at least the Isaac Newton first thought that the two mass attract each other because of gravitational force. Whereas in general theory of relativity, there is nothing called gravitational force, there is only curvature. Space-time curvature, which is more fundamental. There's nothing called force. Okay? So, here, the sun produces the curvature, and the planet like Earth are moving in response to the curvature. That's what the equation represents. Okay? So wherever there is a mass or energy, there should be a curvature. And wherever there is a curvature, there should be a motion of mass. So that's what this figure indicates. Suppose, but this could be understood in another way. Suppose, imagine a situation in the solar system, we are removing the sun out of the solar system. Then what happens? Are there any guess? Yeah. Yes, that is one thing. Then, what will happen to the planets?
There is no convention for them to
fall off. It will fall off on which path?
On a straight path.
Sorry?
Planets.
Exactly, that's right. The planets will fall off in the straight path if you remove the sun. Look at this figure. This is a typical path of a planet, right? Suppose if I'm removing this guy, there won't be any more curvature, so then the balance will go in a straight path and fall off. Therefore, planets are not actually moving in circular or elliptical orbits in the solar system. Rather, planets are actually moving in straight paths in the curvature produced by the sun, right? So what about Newton now? Of course, Newton's theory is beautiful and it's very simple. It's not as complicated as Einstein's theory. What about Newton now? So Einstein concluded that Newton is not completely wrong. He is correct only in a certain region. Let's say inside the solar system, Newton is correct. So beyond that, it is wrong. Whenever the velocity of the object is higher, I mean closer to the speed of light, then Newton fails. Or suppose when the space-time curvature, that is gravity, is higher, then the Newton's theory fails. Okay? So now the question is, where the Newton's theory fails exactly? Are there any guesses? Yes, it has a strong gravitational force. I'll tell you the reason why. Okay? So now, what are black holes? We all know that, like, Namurla, the Kalikundala, Barak Erinju Murja, Kalikunda, Chinna Pisa, Barak, area of the Kuran, the Pisa, then Erinju Murja, the Kapra Suringi, Chinna Chinna, Kalikunda Pisa, so on the way, over stars, so, உள்ள ஃபியூயல்ஸ் பேர்ன் ஆகிட்டு இருக்கும், லைக் ஹீலியம், ஹைட்ரஜன் அந்த மாதிரி. அது அதோட ஏஜ் முடிஞ்சதுக்கப்புறம், எரிஞ்சு முடிஞ்சதுக்கப்புறம் இட் வில் கெட் கம்ப்ரஸ்ட். அது கரித்துள்ள மாதிரி இட் வில் கெட் கம்ப்ரஸ்ட் டு எ ஸ்மாலர் பாடி. ஓகே, அண்ட் தோஸ் ஆர் கால்ட் அஸ் பிளாக் ஹோல்ஸ். வென் த ஸ்டார் லூசஸ் ஆல் தி ஃபியூயல்ஸ், இட் வில் கெட் கம்ப்ரஸ்ட் டு எ வெரி ஸ்மால் பாடி அண்ட் இட் வில் பிகம் அ பிளாக் ஹோல். பட் த க்வெஸ்சன் இஸ், எல்லா ஸ்டார்ஸும் பிளாக் ஹோலாக மாறுமா அப்படின்னா? நோ. த ரீசன் இஸ், there comes an Indian astrophysicist, Subramanian Chandrasekhar, who did his schooling and college in Chennai. He gave a limit, which are the stars which can become black hole. Abhina, only the stars which has at least 1.44 times the mass of the sun. The Surya oda rafa or one rafa irukka stars mattum black hole vara vaipu irukku. Okay, so that limit is called Chandrasekhar limit. Okay, so this is Subramanian Chandrasekhar's signature. It was a great coincidence that in May 2017, that is a few months ago this year, I was invited to give a technical talk on my research at Department of Theoretical Physics, Chalmers University, Prague, which is in Czech Republic country. Okay. There, after giving a talk with all the senior scientists, we were taking coffee. Then a senior scientist, a retired emeritus scientist called Professor Jay Peacock, he asked me, do you know yaarala indha talk irukku mala kuduttaanga theriyuma appo kettaar. So on the talk one day, every month anga nadakkum, it's called the relativity seminar series. Avanga kettaar idhukku mala yaarala kuduttaanga ungalukku theriyuma appo kettaar, theriyadhu appo sonnaar. Then he said, well, adhukku enna kettaar neenga endha ooru enga irundhu varinga appo solla. Then I said Salem appo solla. For them, Salem, it's the Chennai region, the old Madras region, which they know. Okay. So then he immediately said that Subramanian Chandrasekhar has given a talk in the same series in 1991, June 24. Okay. So after giving a talk, like they will be signing it a record. So I'm very thankful to him. He has shown all the old records, and we were searching for this for hours, and then we found out the signature of him, and I took a photo of this. You know. So that was a great coincidence. I was very happy to give a talk there. So now let us define black hole in other way, or we will see the other properties of black holes. Yes, the one definition is, of course, as Chandrasekhar said, it should be at least 1.4 times the mass of the sun. And the second definition is, We know that Namurli Pula often rockets Pala Purposkaga Chitragandaya, climate, this and that. Right? So, for a rocket to go away from the Earth's gravity, there is something called escape velocity. Right? So, the escape velocity of the rocket, it will go out of the Earth's gravitational field, or else it will fall back. So, now we will ask a question: are there any object in the universe such that even the light with its ultimate velocity can never escape? The answer is yes. And those objects are black holes. Suppose what happens when a black hole, when a light goes near to a black hole, the black hole, due to its high gravity, it will pull the light inside, such that the light will keep circling inside or around the black holes. Even light cannot escape with its high velocity, as I shown here, which is 3 followed by 8 zeros meter per second. You cannot imagine this speed. And I should say that this figure is taken from the Interstellar movie. So how many of you have seen the movie Interstellar? Oh, beautiful. Actually, I should say that, you know, this is not just a little graphics card. This Interstellar black hole are the real black holes, which has been simulated by using Einstein's equations, real Einstein's field equations. Okay, and it was the scientific advisor of the movie is Professor Kip Thorne. Another coincidence is Professor Kip Thorne has worked in the same institute where I did my PhD at Leiden, Netherlands. Okay, whereas he was a Lawrence chair of the Lawrence Institute for Theoretical Physics at Leiden University. And in fact, before Christopher Nolan, he has been working in this, working on this story script and so on for 9 years. Okay, and then he made this beautiful movie. Obviously, we cannot see the black holes. Nobody can capture a photo, or we cannot see the black holes. But this is the most realistic black hole which we can see out of the equations. One can simulate through the supercomputers, and that's what's shown in this movie. Just for an information. So now let's go into the physics of it. Black holes are very simple objects. It has mass and spin. Of course, it has one more property, charge, but that's not going to be very relevant for today's discussion. And mostly the realistic black holes does not have charge. So in nature, we will find black holes only with mass and spin. So I will stick to this. And black holes are nothing, technically speaking, black holes are nothing but solutions of Einstein's field equations. Okay? So such a solution was given by a New Zealand mathematician named Roy Patrick Kerr in the year 1963. I was very fortunate to learn about his solution from him himself in September 2010 at the city southern France called Nice. Okay, and he is Professor Riker, who gave the solution, who described the black holes. So now we have seen what is gravity, what is black hole. So now let's ask a question. Are there any questions before that? Before I go into the next one? Yeah. Exactly. Right.
Yes. For non-rotating black
holes,
it was given by
Werner
Instead in
1960. No, that was wrong. It was given by Schwarzschild, Karl Schwarzschild, a German mathematician, a German astrophysicist. It's called Karl Schwarzschild. Yeah. As I said, in nature, nothing is stable. Okay. Well, he's correct. There is something called, theoretically, there is something called a non-rotating black hole. But those are theoretical aspects, okay? Here I'm talking in nature, what we see. In nature, obviously, you know, nothing is stable. Everything is either spinning about its own axis, and it's also spinning around, rotating around some other objects, right? So nothing is stable in the universe. So such a solution, he called it a stable black hole, is a theoretical solution. So now as we have stated, what are black holes? You know, these are very dense, compact objects. like pakkathula enna ponaalum kuda eduthu vachu even light cannot escape, right? So now the question on the yeah. Well, Einstein's theory is purely a classical theory of gravity. Okay, there's no quantum physics here. And a quantum theory of gravity is a nightmare for scientists actually. So far, nobody has achieved it. But that's one of the mysteries of the mankind, I'd say. It's not yet achieved. So that question is completely unanswered question. Yeah. Okay, so now being defined.
Is there any existence of white holes?
What is
that? Existence of white holes.
White holes? No, there is nothing called white holes. There is only wormholes.
Wormholes means
okay. Not according to Einstein so far. Maybe you are talking from some aspects of Hawking's theory, but that is not according to Einstein, and that is not proved experimentally. Sorry, say no to this. Yes, but you see, the black holes or what are the subject which I am discussing today is according to Einstein's theory of relativity. These are completely proven facts, okay? There are so many theories which may postulate such things, but those are not really verified, you know?
Can you say any event origin of the black hole?
Event origin of the
black hole?
You mean event horizon?
Like a boundary
for a black hole. Yeah, okay, I will come to that. Okay, so he is asking, what is the boundary of, okay, he's asking a question, you know, what is the event horizon of a black hole? Which means, well, that's a very good question. That is wrong. Now sometimes black hole pakkathula enna ponaalum ulla eduthukom appdi solrenga. But in the point varaikum poi namma escape aayi vara mudiyum appadina, that is the event horizon. So there is a region around this object, until that region, if you touch that, you can come out safely. But if you touch the horizon, then you will be sucked inside the object. Okay, that's called the event horizon. And that depends on mass and spin of an object. So if the mass is higher and the spin is higher, the event horizon is lower. So now let's go to the real question, or question of mine. What? Yeah, please.
Is there any
effort
black holes?
Sorry?
Is there any end for the black holes?
Well, this is already a dead stage of a star. Okay, there is no end for a black hole. But I will tell you what happens, what will happen to your black hole. That's exactly the same question, yeah? Due to some reason, let's say there is a black hole in the space and there is another object or a star which is coming near to that, something as shown here. Let's assume this is a black hole and there is another object. It can be another black hole or anything else. Let it be a star or a neutron star, whatever. When it comes near to that, the black hole will suck inside, right? But before sucking inside, in physics, as the students know, there is something called angular momentum, right? That is, when two gravitational objects come closer, before they collide, what will happen is, one black hole will try to pull another one, and vice versa, the other will try to suck another black hole. And due to the property called angular momentum, it will start orbiting about its center of the mass or center of gravity. Okay, about its central point, it will start orbiting. Okay, that's what happening in this figure. And it will orbit for decades, many decades, 30, 40 years, and then it will collide. The orbits will keep shrinking, and then it will collide, which is what we will going to see that. Okay. Well, in the earlier slides, I told you that wherever there is a mass, the space-time around the object will get curved, right? After all, we are all masses. Every one of us has mass in our body. So we should also curve the space-time around us, right? Indeed, we are doing that. The space-time around us is getting curved. But the thing is, we are, you know, tiny masses. We are not compact objects like black holes. We are just tiny masses. So we curve the space-time very less. You know, the curvature produced by us is very less around us. Therefore, in principle, according to Einstein's theory of relativity, in principle, any object is producing the spatial curvature around it. And now, what happens if we move? Let's say a falling apple or a moving car, it has curvature around it. And if when it is moving, it should distract the space-time. It means it disturbs the space-time, right? Something like this. We know that nammala generally the kolathula kallu la potirukom ya thannila engayadhu palathani thengilla wall la kolathiyo kallu la potirukom right photo appo naka adoda alaigal vandu karaki kadandu varum ya something like this inga kallu pona appo adoda boundary ku kadandu varum ya so it's exactly something like that. Suppose when two black holes in neutron star potirukku doesn't matter some compact object neutron star is also a compact object. Let's consider these are two black holes only. So when it spirals into each other about a central axis for many years, it distracts the space-time. And the distraction passes through the universe. And the distraction is called the gravitational waves. This has been predicted by Albert Einstein in 1950 in his most beautiful theory, General Theory of Relativity. Okay. And these disturbance, in other words, gravitational waves, travels at the speed of light. So only light and gravitational wave can travel at the speed of light, nothing else. Okay, so as I said, he has predicted this in 1915, right? So, also as I said, it's a theory. After all, any theory should end up in experimental verification, right? Unless, otherwise, it's not a proven fact. So when did we know this experimentally? Is on September 14th, 2015, that is exactly after 100 years of Albert Einstein's prediction, there was two laboratories called laser interferometry gravitational observatory, one in Livingston, United States, and one in Hanford, United States. You know, it detected a signal. As I said, these gravitational waves passed through the universe. Though it got produced in some galaxy or some corner of the galaxy, it splits or passes throughout the universe. Therefore, it should also pass through the air, right? Therefore, when it passes through the air, these two observatories detected. When a gravitational wave passes through the Livingston Observatory and the Hanford Observatory, first it was detected in Livingston, and after 7 milliseconds, it was detected in Hanford. Can you say now why it took 7 milliseconds? Yeah. No. Gravitational waves are waves from the masses, not from electromagnetic waves. Electromagnetic waves and gravitational waves are completely different. The only property they share is the speed, light, the speed of the waves are same, which is the speed of the light.
Is it because gravitational waves and light?
No, that's not Hanford University, Hanford Observatory.
Hanford Observatory is farther than Livingston Observatory.
Yes. But why it took 7 milliseconds exactly?
Sure.
I think I told the answer already.
Sir, light
travels at the speed of light.
Exactly. So since it is traveling at the speed of light, it took 7 milliseconds to travel from Livingston and Hanford. Because we already know the distance between Hanford and Livingston, we can easily calculate what is the speed of the object it is traveling. And this proved that the gravitational waves has a velocity same as the velocity of light. Okay. And the frequency of the wave which this even detected was about 100 hertz, around 100 hertz. Okay. And you know, this signal has passed through the air just only for 0.2 seconds. So we have detected within that 0.2 seconds, we have detected that. And by analyzing those signals, we realized that that signal is coming from a distance far away galaxy of 1.3 billion years. Well, the signal has origin 1.3 billion years ago of two black holes got collided and it has emitted a huge amount of waves. and that's why we receive this. And the readers are, you know, these two black holes had mass, 36 solar mass and 29 solar mass, which is 29 times the mass of our sun. It got collided, it got orbited for several years and it got collided at the end. And the final mass has 62, when these two black holes got collided, it will become a single black hole at the end. And that final black hole has mass 62 times heavier than the sun. It's obvious that if you sum up 36 plus 29, it should be 65, right? So the three solar mass is missing. So what happened to that? Any answer?
Loss of energy.
What energy?
Gravity.
Sorry? Yeah, true. Because you're right. So the energy.
There's mass loss in the form of heat.
Sorry, say again. Say louder, please.
Those mass may be lost in the form of heat energy.
No. It lost because of, as I said, it is spiraling. These two black holes got spiraled and it got collided at the end. During the spiral and the collision, it disturbs the space-time and it loses energy. Systems loses energy in the form of gravitational wave energy. And those has been traveling from there to here. So those are gravitational waves. So you can imagine, three times the mass of our sun got converted into gravitational waves. Okay? And one more actual property of gravitational waves is, it cannot be distracted by anything, unlike electromagnetic waves. Suppose if there is light here, and if you place a door or a window, the light cannot go outside this hall, right? You can easily stop the light, you can easily stop the electromagnetic waves, but you cannot stop, you can never ever stop gravitational waves. You will just pass through your body, or you can even pass through the air, and it will just go away, you know? So by now, there are two objects which will pass through everything. One is neutrino, and the second one is gravitational waves. Either you like it or not, you believe it or not, it will just pass through your body. It is passing through your body all the time. We have to go through a detailed calculations based on Einstein's relativity. You have to model the two black holes, and you have to predict the orbits, and you have to predict the gravitational waves. Then you will, by match with the theory, you know, with this deduction, you will get the data. The experiments will give you data. Then if you match the data with the theory, you will realize what are the masses it comes from, and how much energy it got lost, and so on. Okay, here the picture says the same thing. The two black holes get inspired for many years. After that, it gets collided, and at the end, it will become a single black hole. Okay, but this is a cartoon. Okay, and during the inspiral, it emits a certain amount of gravitational waves, and during the collision, it emits a huge amount of gravitational waves. At the end, it will become zero because the two black holes become single. And you know, this particular event, this is the very first deduction done by our mankind. This event has emitted the power which was greater than all the powers emitted by all the stars in the visible universe. Okay, you can imagine how violent the event was. This is the most violent event ever observed by the mankind. Okay, so what we gained by this deduction is, it confirms the existence of black holes, first of all, because until this, the black holes are theoretical concept. It was only after this deduction, for sure we know that black holes exist in the universe. And this also confirms that binary black holes exist in the universe, and gravitational waves are also existing in the universe. So let's see this in a movie. this is nothing but what I have been explaining so far. You know, two black holes are orbiting each other. Of course, it will slow our orbit, it will be super fast, almost close to the speed of light, because of its high gravity. But in the movie, it is shown as low velocity. When the two black holes come closer to each other, it emits a huge amount of gravitational waves, as shown in that cartoon. When it is getting closer and closer, it emits a huge amount of gravitational waves, right? At the end, these two black holes merge together to form a single black hole. Then there won't be any more gravitational waves from the dark point. Let's say 50 to 100 or 5 to 100 solar masses are classified as stellar mass black holes. There is another kind called supermassive black holes, which has the same property as the black hole which I have been describing. But the mass of these objects are much, much higher than the Sun. Let's say a million times the mass of our Sun, or even billion times the mass of our Sun. Okay? Such black holes exist in our galaxy center. So now the question is, what happens when a small black hole goes near to a supermassive black hole? Let's say this has about 10 solar mass weight, and this has 1 million solar mass. So now, you see, we have seen in the movie that when two black holes of similar mass comes closer to each other, it will start orbiting around a central point, right? So now when a smaller black hole comes near to a bigger black hole, what happens? Yes, it will absorb by the bigger one, but before that, yes, please.
The small black hole orbits the big black hole.
Exactly. So the smaller black hole will orbit around the bigger black hole for many, many years. Okay, that's what will happen. And eventually, as he said, after orbiting for several decades, it will also fall into a bigger black hole. Okay. During that time, it also emits gravitational waves, and those waves will be, you know, the frequency of such waves will be in the range of millihertz. But this is actually my research topic. So what happens when a smaller black hole or a smaller star goes near to a supermassive black hole? That's what I have been doing since last four years for my PhD and afterwards. Okay? What is the name of our galaxy? Right. As I said, almost all galaxies has supermassive black holes in their centers. You know, in fact, the galactic dynamics, as I said, nothing is stable. Everything is in motion, right? The moon is orbiting around the Earth, and the planets are moving, orbiting around the Sun, and the Sun is also orbiting around something. The Sun is also orbiting around the galaxy, okay? And these dynamics, the dynamics of stars has been governed by the supermassive black holes in their galactic centers. For example, our galaxy Milky Way has a supermassive black hole in our galactic center, and the name of the guy is Sagittarius A star. And close to that Milky Way, there are 28 stars are orbiting. You know, this figure, this is actually a technical figure, which implies, imagine there is a supermassive black hole here, and these 28 stars orbit in this crazy pattern. It can have any kind of orbits. It need not be an elliptical orbit or a circular orbit, as we know from our solar system. It can be any kind of orbits, as shown in this. So my interest was finding what are these objects are in a more precise equations, as Madam asked. So how we will detect the gravitational waves, how we will understand these objects, you know, only if you know the formula, a precise formula, which can be matched with the data, then you will know what these objects are in the universe. Because, you see, these are the objects. Okay, let me put it in this way. If you want to see what is happening in the moon, even you can see, I mean, you can take a picture through camera and you can see the craters, right? And if you want to see a star nearby, you can use a telescope. Then you can observe the light from the star. Then you can realize that, okay, there is a star there. But these black holes are black. It does not emit light. But how do you identify this? So the gravitational waves are the only material through which we can understand this. So only if you receive the gravitational waves through the experiments, then you can predict what's happening and where does it comes from and how far it comes from and which object it comes from and so on. Okay. For that, you need a mathematics which explains very clearly this. So that's what I have been doing. I started my PhD in May 7th July 2013 in Leiden, Netherlands. Then we found, suppose a smaller black hole is orbiting around a bigger black hole. What can be this? What can be orbits? I found a circular orbit. That will be one possible orbit, as shown here. Okay, but again, I stated already that it need not be a simple orbit like circular orbit. It can be very complicated. Right. Before going into the second kind of orbits, okay, let me stop for a moment. If you have questions so far, yes.
Let's say there's a black hole next to our planet Earth, like not directly next to it, but quite close to it. Can this black hole's gravity change the time of Earth?
First of all, there is no black hole in the solar system.
No, like hypothetically.
Uh-huh.
It can, if there was a black hole quite near to Earth, and because of its gravitational, the bend in the space time. Can it just change the time on Earth? Can it affect?
It does affect. Either huge gravity or fastness affects the time, as I said in the Einstein's thought experiment. Have you seen the movie Interstellar?
Yeah.
Okay, so then you should know that, suppose if a planet is, suppose if a planet is orbiting around a black hole instead of orbiting around the sun, then what happens? The answer is that time runs very slowly when you are traveling faster or when you are traveling in the vicinity of high gravity. Okay, I would say before going into that, since we have time, I will say another example. Please don't. So there is another thought experiment by Albert Einstein called tweet paradox. Have you heard of it? Yeah. Suppose when there are two twins, let's say two brothers. Okay. So they are born on the Earth, and immediately one of the guy has been sent in a space shuttle or rocket, which can travel closer to the speed of light. Of course, nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. So that's why I say closer to the speed of light. So then, after 40-50 years, if that guy is coming back to the Earth, if the rocket is coming back to the Earth, then the guy on the Earth will be older. His age will be 50, right? If it is coming after 50 years. But what will be the age of the guy who has been traveling in the rocket, which is closer to the speed of light? Something like that. So the age of the guy who has been traveling close to the speed of light will be very, very less. The reason is when you travel with a very high speed, if the clock rate, let's say if any clock for that matter, let's say our usual clock or even the heartbeat, the tick rate will be very slow. So that's why he won't be aged as that of the same as the same age as that of the Earth. Okay. So for his question, when a guy lives on a planet which is orbiting around a black hole, then what happens is for him the time runs very, very slowly compared to the guy on the Earth. Okay. So, since we talked about that movie, one hour on a planet which is orbiting around the black hole is 7 hours, 7 years for a guy who lives on the Earth. So that's why we funnily say that it's better to do the PhD there so that we can finish it faster. Let us understand what Einstein said about the orbits of planets. Suppose the planet Mercury is orbiting, let's imagine this as a sun and this is a Mercury. Suppose when Mercury is orbiting around the sun, he predicted that after every orbit, the planet ends ahead of the starting point. As shown in this figure, can you see the red line around this? Okay, beautiful. So after every orbit, suppose when a planet starts here, after the orbit, it goes ahead of this. And this pattern is called Periaston shift, as described by Einstein's theory. And Einstein predicted this accurately, very accurately. In fact, this was one of the very successful experiments which proved that Einstein was correct in the early 1950s. Sorry, 1915, 16, around the time. So now what happens? This is for the case of a planet around the sun, okay? So what happens when a black hole orbit around the another black hole? Yeah. Yeah, this pattern is called Periaston shift. Yes, it is. Yeah, because every time it is not following the same orbit, it follows different orbit, right? After every orbit, there is a shift in the orbit, and the reason for this shift is due to the space-time perturbation produced by the sun. So now let's see what happens when a smaller black hole orbits around a supermassive black hole. Something a similar phenomenon should exist, right? Because both are either a planet and the sun, or two black holes, or gravitational objects. So a similar pattern should follow. Exactly, it follows similar pattern, but there is a difference we found. Okay. So now assume this is a smaller black hole and this is a supermassive black hole. When a smaller black hole orbits around a supermassive black hole, you could see the pattern of this. As Einstein described, of course, after every orbit, there is a shift in the orbit, as shown in this figure. But there is an additional feature. If you connect all these endpoints in the case of planet, it forms a circle. But here, it does not form a circle. This is a major research or discovery which we formed in Netherlands with three other colleagues of mine. Okay, and the reason of this is supermassive black holes has extreme gravity compared to the sun. Okay, sun's gravity is too weak to show this effect, whereas the supermassive black hole has the gravity is very extreme. So that's why we see this effect. You can see that the radius is also shifting every time. The same thing as is shown in this figure. When you start in this orbit, after this, there is a shift in the radius. There is a decrease in the radius here. There is an increase in this. There is a shift in this radius, and that's because of the supermassive black hole's gravity. Okay, as I said, this has been done with three other colleagues, Giuseppe D'Ambrosi from Italy, and Van de Wies from Netherlands, and he's our supervisor, Professor Envelum and Horten from Netherlands. Okay, and there is a third kind of orbit which we predicted. When a smaller black hole, again, orbits around a supermassive black hole, it need not be, okay, let me say that these orbits are in the plane. Look, this smaller black hole is orbiting around this bigger black hole in a plane, right? Similarly, this is also in the plane, only the radius is varying, right? The change is only in two dimensional, which is the plane. But here, it need not be following the, it need not be, No, it's not the same case. As I said, you cannot see that, you know, Earth follows this pattern, for example. It will be, you know, after every orbit, there will be a based on shift, of course. But the radius won't be different. The reason is Sun's gravity is weak compared to the supermassive black hole's gravity. This happens only in the case of black holes. Okay, so there is a third kind of orbit we predicted. So because this object is spinning, the smaller black hole is spinning, also the bigger black hole is also spinning, due to the spinning, you know, the black hole can also go in a wavy pattern, something like this. Okay, so this is a third result. And there is another coincidence. This was for Earth-Moon system, the Earth and Moon also follows a similar pattern. But the thing is, we don't see this effect much because it will be very, very, very tiny. Okay. And for Earth Moon, it was first predicted by William D. Sitter, as well as Einstein gave this theory in 1915. William D. Sitter from Leiden University, where I got my PhD, he predicted it immediately for Earth Moon system. And exactly after 100 years, I predicted it for two black holes. The same effect has been generalized for black holes. Okay. So now, we have seen a case when two black holes, that is when two stellar mass black holes around 50 solar mass, when it orbits around, we can detect the gravitational waves by using the LIGO experiments. So now the question is how we will detect these effects. These are after all theories and we need to see it in experiments, right, to make it fact. So now the European Space Agency is working on an observatory. And these objects cannot be detected by the LIGO, the laser interferometer gravitational observatory, which is on the Earth. The reason is that will detect the frequency around 100 Hertz, not the millihertz frequency. Therefore, the European Space Agency is constructing a new observatory, which is called European Laser Interferometer Space Antenna, shortly it's called ELISA. That will be launched in 2014, and that will be set up above the Earth. You know, that will be set up in space above the Earth, and the whole observatory will be moving along with the Earth, as shown in this figure. You know, this is the observatory, like a triangle, is clearly shown here. So this will follow the orbit around the Earth. While it is orbiting, it will receive the signals from the outer space, that is the gravitational waves from the outer space, and it will send the signal to the Earth. Then after analyzing that, we can see where does the flare comes from, and that is. That is scheduled to be launched in 2034, at least 17 years from now. And what we will gain by studying this is we will understand what are the, well, where the stars, black holes are existing, and what are their masses, and what are their spin, and so on. We will study their properties. Basically, we will understand the universe around it. You know? Even we can understand how it has got formed, how the black holes has got formed, can be understood from these signals. So now let's see a detailed movie of what I have been describing now. And do you have any questions before going to that?
Why don't we have shift?
Sorry?
Why don't we have a shift in orbit?
Which shift do you mean? This one?
Yes.
This one?
Yes.
Yeah, that's because, as I said, the sun or a black hole is creating the curvature around it. Okay, the curvature determines how the body should move. Okay, so the curvature is responsible for this shift. No, curvature is not keep changing. Curvature determines how the object should move. Not exactly. You know, in principle, strictly speaking, it's not just Earth is orbiting around the sun. Even Earth is spinning, right? Also, Earth is also moving. The only thing is the center of mass is very close to the sun, such that we see the planets are orbiting around that. So it is changing, basically. So to speak, maybe we can say that the temperature is changing. Maybe there is a small change. So that is the reason for this. Yes. Yes.
What's the relationship between aerospace engineering and astrophysics?
Yeah, aerospace engineering, as you said, it's all about dealing with the vehicles which we use around the Earth or outside the Earth for space travel, okay? And the astrophysics is all about studying the entire universe around us, the big objects, the macroscopic objects like planets or galaxies, black holes, stars, and so on.
So, how much astrophysics is required for aerospace engineer to be there? Rockets, launches, something like that.
Well, it's not required. If you are interested, you can study as much as you want. But aerospace engineering is, as you said, it's all about techniques, right? You know, that's okay. Let me put it this way. The engineering in general is all about using the existing scientific laws and creating the kind of machines which we need for our everyday life, right? But this astrophysics is nothing but a fundamental science which always looks for what is around us or what we are made of. Yeah. Yes, please.
Okay. Gravitational waves pass through everything. How do you detect them?
Right. In other words, you are asking what is the principle of this interferometer, right? The LIGO interferometer. It's nothing but the principle of Michelson-Morley interferometer. That is, suppose when there is a light when you are sending a light beam, there is a mirror. Let's say it splits the light beam into two. And there are two other mirrors at the end. One light beam passes through the mirror. Both goes and comes back. When you receive it, you will see one light has time delay compared to the other. And now when the gravitational wave passes through that, it will cause additional time delay. And from the time delay, you can measure that only the gravitational waves which has been possible. From its properties, we can predict that it is only gravitational waves and nothing else. These questions I will come at the end because these are, as I said, more kind of unanswered questions. Yes, orbits each other and collides with each other.
If a single black hole is there without orbiting another black hole, we can't
detect gravitational waves. Okay, so focus. I mean, in order to explain it easily, then I use the word two black holes. It can be a star also. Suppose the star is orbiting around a black hole, it can still produce the gravitational waves. for any object which is, as I said, any object which is in motion produces gravitational waves. But the thing is, how much amount depends on the mass of the object. Suppose if I am running, I do produce gravitational waves, I do disturb the space time. But the amount I produce is very, very high. But these objects are compact objects which has huge mass, 10 times, 100 times the sun. When it moves, it disturbs a lot. And that produces a huge amount of waves. In principle, yes. That's what I have been saying. In principle, any motion, any object which is under motion produces gravitational waves. But you cannot detect those because it produces very tiny amount of gravitational waves. You don't have a very, very, very sensitive instrument to detect those. As I said, I will show you this slide. You see, when there are black holes of 36 and 29 times the times of 39 times that of sun, then you could detect gravitational waves of frequency from 40 to 216 hertz. Suppose when there is a small black hole, when it is already orbiting a bigger black hole, then the frequency, you can see that it's a millihertz frequency, which means one followed by 1,000. times the Hertz, okay, which is very, very tiny. For this quotient, when the air moves, indeed it produces gravitational waves, but it is very, 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 very tiny than this. You can never get that. No, we don't have the instrument now. We have not created so far. Maybe in future, you guys should come up and detect that. Any object which is under motion produces gravitational waves. Anything, anything. Okay, even if you shake the hand, if you run, you are producing gravitational waves. But the question is if we can detect that or not. We cannot detect at the moment.
Yeah?
It won't affect the nearby object. It will just pass through them.
Distance, not time. Because the person who's standing outside the train is
okay. I will put it this way. both the things happen. Time dilates as well as the distance changes. So that is technically called as a lent contraction, you know. Both the things happen. That depends on its mass and spin. Higher the mass, higher the spin, then the escape velocity is higher. Okay, so I should say that maybe not this. Okay, we should give chance to the people who has not asked questions. Please.
Now, I wanted to know how did you get the localized depression in space time, for instance, supermassive black holes? Do you think that there is no general pattern in the existence of galaxies across the universe? Except that you can say that they are. How did we get these dents in space-time from the beginning? How did they form across the universe? It doesn't seem like there's some driving force behind it. So you wouldn't get such huge collections of mass without some, what do you say, a push or an initiation.
True. If I understood your question properly, then you are asking how these supermassive black holes has formed, right? It's true that it's not easy to, or it's not, it won't happen immediately for an object to become a supermassive black hole. After all, the stars has masses lesser than the supermassive black holes. It means when the stars becomes a normal black hole or a stellar black hole, let's say, then it might have attracted other black holes or other objects around it. And after a long period, it would have been known as a supermassive black hole. Okay, so I want to stop here because I want to show you an important movie before you go for further questions. Okay? Because I don't want to be missed this. Okay, so before going to this, just a small correction. As I said, that this space observatory is going to be set up around 2024. In this video, it is mentioned as 2024 or around 20. So just don't mind that. But the current data, because it's an old movie, so the current data says it's around 2024. Just keep that in mind. But the rest are as is shown in this movie.
Thank you.
system around around that, which means not followed by a loop of 10, right? So you will see how tiny the effect is. With this kind of science, we can found that the existence of black holes and binary black holes and gravitational waves after 100 years of prediction. So with this, a new branch of astronomy has begun. It's called gravitational wave astronomy. And with the gravitational waves, we can map the entire universe. You know, just today in Germany, the German government has announced a span which shows the gravitational waves. Yeah. Thank you.
Definitely.
Suppose, actually, gravitational waves means waves in a conventional sense. Does it have a wavelength and a frequency as always?
Exactly.
Okay.
But the properties are different.
Okay.
But these wavelength and frequencies are conventional.
Suppose the two gravitational waves intersect or superimpose with one another, what would be the consequence of it?
Well, even if two gravitational wave interacts, superimpose, it's still a gravitational wave. But it depends on which direction it gets interacted, and these things needs to be analyzed technically by using the equations. We cannot say just like that. It depends on which direction it comes from. But it will still be a gravitational wave, which can be detected and analyzed.
So if the
it's visible only in Einstein's equation. That's why we say it has been predicted by Einstein.
But does it have predicted stars that lightning path can travel in the equation?
I don't hear you.
But does it, the scientist who predicted that gravitational waves can exist in a lightning path of some star?
At least I have not seen a paper by him which is explained by him.
Orient plasma.
No, first it was predicted by Einstein. You can trust me. No, it was bad. Yeah. Because of the frequency, it has low frequency. We need a very sensitive instrument to detect that. And it took about 40 years to construct this LIGO experiments to detect those. Because of the the technical difficulties. Yes. Pastor. We can measure it through experiments. We cannot feel it. Humans cannot feel it, or you cannot see it. We can only measure it through experiments.
In general relativity, time dilates with the gravitation also. Both the gravitational time dilates.
Yes.
Suppose if there is a gravitational wave, very intense gravitational wave, it distorts time also.
Exactly. Definitely, yeah. Because gravitational wave is nothing but a form of energy, right? If there is an intense energy, either it's energy or mass, it should distract space and time. Yes. Well, it depends on, as I said to him, it depends on the direction. It may get nullified or it may get intense. It depends on the direction. Maybe. Particular point where it depends on both objects, mass and spin. suppose if you say me that, okay, this black hole has this mass and this black hole has this spin, then I can tell you where the center of mass will be.
What about the singularity?
Okay, singularity is, you know, I didn't answer a few questions earlier, I mean, he's asking one of those. The singularity is, you know, the point where this gravity becomes infinity. But again, and that's a place where Einstein thinks. There we don't know what is happening, we don't know what is happening inside the time. And Einstein's theory is not successful in explaining that. And that's why we need a much better theory, like quantum theory of gravity.
Is there any corrections for that?
Sorry?
Is there any corrections for that?
It's not that we need a correction, it's that we need a new theory itself. We need completely a new theory. So that's what people are working on. Okay, it depends on its orientation. It depends on these two objects' orientation, the final black hole will be.
Okay, so after colliding with each other, what happens, sir?
The final black hole does spin.
Sir?
The final black hole will also be spinning about its own axis.
Whether greater or faster or slower?
It depends on the orientation of these two guys. You know, if there is, you suppose if these two objects have the same axis, then it will get decreased. Suppose if it is, you know, anti-parallel, let's say spinning, then it will get decreased. It depends on the orientation. Okay, I think that's the last question.
Hello.
Yes.
I have two questions. One is a black. You said supermassive black holes and normal black holes, right? So what makes a black hole supermassive?
It's
black hole and everything of a black hole is within its singularity, isn't it? And so how do you know which is...
Okay, let me make it clear. Let us not confuse about singularity. Okay, singularity is a theoretical concept where the gravity is infinite. But what we have been discussing is what we know for sure, okay? So, it's not that everything is under singularity. There is a black hole, and there is a particular region in the black hole, theoretically, which is called a singularity.
Just one more question. Actually, I have to ask another friend also. A debate arose between Stephen Hawking and a few other astrophysicists a few years ago. And what Stephen Hawking then said is he ruled out the concept of black holes, and then he brought in a new one called gray holes. And I would like to know
what
he ruled out the concept of black holes and the event horizon.
Okay.
And he brought in a new concept of gray holes.
Okay.
And so
let me first answer for this. He cannot rule out this because we have proved this experimentally. So black holes doesn't exist.
He redefined black holes.
No, black holes are defined by Einstein's equations clearly. As Einstein clearly described, we have formed experimentally. So he has redefined theory, but that's not what we see in experiments.
And my friend also wishes to ask how the data is taken from the Ellis and Leigo experiments to calculate that they are gravitational waves. I mean, what more do we get from them?
Well, then we go into the details of data analysis, you know. I don't want to go into those technical details for now.
It's time to wind up.
Okay, thank you.
We have come to the end of the program, and now it is time for vote of thanks. We thank Dr. Satish Kumar Saravanan for the wonderful talk on space-time. He gave a down-to-earth explanation. He gave a down-to-earth explanation about gravitational waves and black holes. The young scientists, the children, have made the session very interactive. The Secretary, Department of School Education, Government of Tamil Nadu, the Director and the Joint Director of Anna Centenary Library and the Chennai District Library Officer are instrumental in bringing this wonderful science talk to you. On behalf of the entire team of Anna Centenary Library, we express our sincere thanks to them. We express our heartfelt thanks to the audience who have come from distant places to attend the program. We thank TVA for the video coverage. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of well-motivated and dedicated colleagues. We thank them for their support and encouragement. Thank you, everyone.
Before we close, I would like to thank all the organizers for organizing this event. Not because I was invited as a speaker. Just now, the joint director, Dr. V. Kumar, told me that, I requested him to continue these science talks as a periodic event in our university, and he immediately agreed for that. And he told me to organize the further speakers, so I would be very happy to do that. So this event is going to be continued, and I'm very happy about that, and I hope you guys do.